So, as I told you in the earlier part of this lecture, rather last part of the earlier session, that this single point, output point, will stretch towards the values of two classes, either 1 minus 1 or 1 0. Fine. So, what we do is we modify this architecture. Before modifying the architecture, what we have discussed is to calculate error. Now, see here. O is the actual output that is given by sigma k is equal to 0 to n minus wk xk. Okay. Minus OT, that is target output. This will give me error. This is error for an ith single input pattern. Fine. Now, suppose this is giving me 0.6, and the pattern, according to the available supervised training data, belongs to first class or class above the linear boundary. Instead of 0.6, I will try to force it to 1. I will try to force it to 1. So my error will be whatever is WK XK that I told you, 0.6 minus OT, that is output target is 1. So 0.6 minus 1, that is minus 0.4 is the error. Fine. This is how we calculate error of every output node. Fine. Now, suppose I have got large number of input patterns. My effort is to minimize the mean squared error. You already know this approach. Everybody has studied this somewhere in mathematics or interpolation or regression. We use mean squared error. So, see here, sigma wk xk minus ot is error. We square it, then we find out summation. Okay, you already know that mean is nothing but summation of the error, okay, and divided by number of elements. That divided by part we drop because we want to minimize error, squared error, and that error will be minimum whenever the sum will be minimum. That divided by n, you already know division operation is computationally complex, so we need not implement it. Even if you drop it, and if you minimize sum of the square, okay, sum of squared error minimization, if you do it, that will be fine. It will have the same effect as minimizing the mean squared error. This 1.2 value we add for our convenience, computational convenience. If you read the details further, in detail further slides, you will find why we have added this 1/2. This is squared error. Okay. Now we want to differentiate this, as I have already told you. We have to minimize squared error. So we'll have to sum squared error. We'll have to differentiate it. The differentiation is given in the next step. Okay. WK XK minus OT. Now, by this time, you might have already understood why I have added this 1/2 in the squared error formula. Because here it is that WK XKI minus OTI bracket has got power of 2. When you differentiate it, it will be 2 into WK XI minus OTI, and this 2 and 1/2 gets cancelled. Fine. So I define my squared error as half of the sum squared error. Fine. So this 2 and 1/2 to get cancelled, so that further we do not have to worry about this 2. Otherwise, at every step, you will have to multiply by 2. Rather than that, we are now minimizing this error called as half the sum squared error. Now we have got this gradient error with respect to WK. Why with respect to WK? Because I want to find out formula of modification for the values of W. Our aim is to update weights W1 to WN. So I have found out this differential of sum squared error with respect to WK. So this is the differential, and this differential is nothing but the gradient of the squared error with respect to WK. Now, the new weight values are given by the weight update equation. How is the weight update equation? See that it is very that way it is very simple. WK is the old weight, rather I should have written it here WK n plus 1, indicating the time in the time or iteration, next iteration. Wk is the current weight, that is Wkn minus eta into, note this entity now. This is nothing but gradient, gradient of the squared error. I have written here after the minus sign. Now this eta is the learning rate. Okay, because you already know what is the error. Whatever is the error, if you try to correct it in the single pass, the system may become unstable. Error has to be removed very slowly. In real life system also, whatever is the error, whatever is the improvement required, you may not be able to implement the improvement in a single step. So in the first iteration, you may improve some 0.5 by 0.5. If your total improvement required is 1, in the first iteration, you may improve it by 0.5. In the second iteration, again by 0.25. In the third iteration, again by 0.15. And this is how you gradually approach towards the target. Trying to achieve the target in single step may make the system unstable, may generate oscillations. That's why this eta constant is usually between 0 to 1. If it is 1, it means you are trying to improve the error in one go, in one step, and that will generate oscillations in the system. Okay. Now there are various techniques of training. You will calculate error for one batch, that is one pattern. You can calculate even error for single sample. Okay. And then apply this algorithm. Depending upon that, it will be called as batch training. If you calculate the total sum of error for complete batch, batch means batch of input patterns, then it is called batch training. If you calculate it for single pattern, then it is called as stochastic training. So there are various approaches of training. At this stage, I won't go into details of that, neither we have that much time. But this correction of this error in every weight, see here Wk, next weight of Wk will be given by Wk means current value minus eta multiplied by this value calculated by gradient, gradient error, or gradient of error. This gives you next weight. So this you will apply for every weight. So go on applying input pattern, go on calculating error for every pattern, calculate the summation of the error, and apply this equation for modification of all the weights. Okay. In case of batch training, you will update the weight after the complete batch. In case of stochastic training, you will improve the weight after every sample. That is what is the difference between batch training and stochastic training. Thus, each new weight is computed as original weight minus the learning rate eta multiplied by gradient of the error. This is called the very fundamental gradient descent algorithm. Gradient descent means what? Rate of change of error or gradient of error is going to reduce. It is going to descend. That's why gradient descent algorithm. If output is more than target, output weights are reduced. If output is less than target, then weights are increased. This continues till target equals to output. Target OT equals to output O. The constant eta is selected, usually much less than 1, for smooth learning. The output is modified so as to reduce the error in the output. I have tried to write many things in the slides because I am aware that during the presentation, sometime audio will go off. So that time you should have material to read in the slides. That's why I have typed many things in the slides. Now see this curve. See this curve. What does it describe? Input is plotted on x-axis, output is plotted on y-axis. If input is more than 0, the output will be forced towards 1. If input is less than 0, output will be forced towards 0. As I have already given you the earlier situations, in one case, the output will be forced towards 1. Other case, the output will be forced towards 0 or minus 1 whatsoever. Now, this example shows if the input is more than 0, forcing the output towards 1. If the input is less than 0, forcing the output towards 0. It will be implemented by this curve, red curve shown in this diagram. How it will be done? Let the earlier k is equal to 0 to n, wk xk. Note that I have now included the bias in the form of weights. In my earlier slides, you will find that bias is included in weights. And I am considering for bias k is equal to 0. Earlier it was k is equal to 1 to n. Now this equation is k is equal to 0 to n including bias. So I consider t is equal to this equation, complete summation of weight multiplied by input feature. Now I take a function f of t that is equal to 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to minus t. And this e raised to minus t, if I substitute t, will look like this. At t is equal to 0, ft is equal to 0.5. Now this 0.5 is nothing but boundary of the class, that is between 1 and 0. See the diagram below. Instead of 1 and minus 1, I have now taken it 0 and 1. It is our choice. We can displace this curve downwards, multiply it by 2, and also can take between 1 and minus 1. Instead of 0 to 1, we can also get the outputs 1 and minus 1. That is not a big issue. Only you need to modify some computations. At t is equal to infinity, as you can see, f of t is equal to 1. So if you have value of t, that is sigma wk xk, is considerably greater than 0, this function will give 1 output. If it is considerably less than 1, then it will give 0 output. If I multiply this function by 2 and add a DC constant, it can give me the values 1 and minus 1 also. Now, this f of t, 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to minus t. Somebody may say that, oh, there are many other functions, like there might be tan hyperbolic and so on. Why are we considering only this? To start with, we are considering this. But there are other functions also available. There is a specific advantage corresponding to this function. And what is that? You already know that we have to consider differential of the error. And differential of this function, without much calculation, you can calculate. Otherwise, you already know, calculating a differential on computers, you will have to solve that discrete mathematics problem. Okay? But this function has got a very peculiar advantage. And what is that? This following differential explains it. Df by dt, if I calculate with respect to t, dft by dt, then it will be like this. Minus 1 multiplied by 1 plus e raised to minus t raised to minus into 2 into e raised to minus 2 minus t into minus 1. This is given by e raised to minus t divided by 1 plus e raised to minus t square. Now I won't explain how this differential is calculated. All of you have already studied differential. So this gives me 1 minus ft f of t. What does this mean? What does this mean? This means if ft is given to me without solving a discrete mathematics problem, I can straightaway use this formula, 1 minus f of t into f of t, and that will give me the differential of this function. And that will save a lot of my computations. That will save a lot of my computations. Now, why do I require this? Why do I require this? I require this because in the gradient descent, if I add this particular block, add the output of our earlier perceptron, I will require differential of this ft also. This differential dft by dt, it will become part of gradient descent algorithm. So I am writing further mathematics here. DE by dw is equal to 1 minus f of t, because finally I want gradient of error with respect to w. So 1 minus f of t into f of t is this much. And error we already know, it was O minus OT, that is target error, multiplied by XKI or XK. Fine. So this is what is the gradient descent. And then we can write the weight modification formula, WKI is equal to WKI minus eta, ft 1 minus ft, then ft minus ot into xki, where I represents the ith training pattern. Means what? For every pattern, I will have to apply it to the as input to this diagram. For that, I will have to calculate error. Okay. I will have to calculate summation of the error for whole batch, if it is batch training, or if it is a stochastic training, then for every pattern, I have to separately calculate the error, find out squared sum of error, and find out its gradient. So that gradient will be implemented by this DE by DW. Now you see here, no differential calculation is there. Whatever entities are available with you on the basis of value of this function 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to minus t, O is the actual calculated output, sigma wk xk, O minus t is the target, it will be 1 or 0, and xki is the current input. So all are known quantities, so you can calculate error gradient with respect to w only using the available quantities. This largely simplifies the calculations. And then if you calculate this, then you can further write this weight update formula. Wki is equal to wki. This wki is n plus 1th iteration, and this wki is nth iteration, minus eta into ft, 1 minus ft, and dash dash dash, all this equation will come into picture. So this is how you implement the gradient descent. Now see here, this red ft block in this diagram is nothing but this equation, 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to minus t. So if I substitute this, output will now be given by O is equal to f of t is equal to f of sigma k is equal to 0 to whatever value n wk xk, that is 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to minus k is equal to 0 to n wk xk. The weight updation rule using gradient descent algorithm for stochastic training is given by this is error, then output target is constant, so wki is equal to this one. So this is what is the final weight updation formula for gradient descent with this, with added nonlinearity. Fine. Now note that here still only one output is there for both the classes, 1 and 0. And the same problem will be there which was earlier there. Same output will be fetched, stretched to our class 1 as well as class 0. Fine. Now what we do is we convert it into two class. So there will be two output neurons. Now see this diagram. Everything is same except there are two neurons now. At the output, there are two nodes. Now what will happen? O1 will go high for class 1 while O2 will go 0. And for class 2, O2 will go high and O1 will go 0. But now what is the cost paid? You have given two separate nodes for two classes. But what is the cost paid? Cost paid is you have got one more set of weights. Instead of W1 to Wn, W0 to Wn, now you have got W01, W11, W121, Wn1. Similarly, W02, W12, W22, and Wn2. You have got more weights. And now see the equation. Now instead of only one row of weights, you have now got two rows of weights. While there is one input variable, vector. And this is going to give me output 1, output 2. For output 1, O1 will be 1, O2 will be 0. And for output 2, or class 2, O1 will be 0, O2 will be 1. This is how you can now train this network, but again using the gradient descent. Nothing new. Now I will move through it very fast. The basic concept. Now this is training of two-class classifier. The only thing here now will be you will have to consider appropriate error, whether it is error 1 or error 2, and accordingly you will have to update W01, Wn1, W02 to Wn2 depending upon which class the input pattern belongs to. But again, the formula, though those are derived here, I won't go into each and every formula in detail, but individually at leisure You can go through each of these formula and we'll find that those are derived only using those earlier gradient descent basic formula, fine. But then there are two output neurons now. Now, let us go to the next one, generalized architecture for an M class. Now, instead of only two classes, I have already told you, for discriminating between male and female, I require only two classes. But if I want to identify student, then there were 10 students in that table. So I will require output corresponding to A to output corresponding to J. So I will require M classes. So I require M neurons in the output. So see here in the output layer, there are M neurons. 1, 2, dash, dash, dash up to M. Features might be including bias, there will be N plus 1 features. And there are two neurons. Two layers of neurons, output layer and input layer. Now such two layer perceptron, they are able to implement linear boundaries. They are able to implement linear boundaries. Fine, multi-class linear boundaries. However, many real life applications will not be able to implement, you will not be able to solve those problems by using linear boundaries only. So you may have to add hidden layers also. Then training of M class classifier, it is on the similar lines. Once your ideas are clear for two layer, extension of it is done to M class classifier using the same mathematics again. Even you can go for, this is multi-class two layer classifier. I have added one hidden layer here. And weights of this hidden layer, they are calculated using chain rule. Okay. Again, I won't go into details of this chain rule, but this multi-class two layer classifier is nothing but extension of multi-class single layer classifier or one output and one input layer classifier. Now, when you talk about two layer, the input layer is neglected. Input layer is neglected. Only output layer and one hidden layer it is considered. Then you can have multiple hidden layers. You can have multiple hidden layers like this. There are large number of output classes. There can be large number of hidden layers. And at every layer, you will implement that chain rule for gradient descent. And you will try to derive their weight updation formulas. They are nothing but the extension of gradient descent for various layers. For calculation of gradient descent for the middle layer, you will have to use the chain rule of differentiation. Now, I won't go into details of chain rule of differentiation, neither do we have that much time. But for multi-class, training of multi-class classifier, you will have to use it. Now, the issue is why I have handled this multi-class classifiers in so detail. The reason is, in every deep neural network, the feed-forward multi-class classifier, multi-layer feed-forward, fully connected neural network is unavoidable part of the deep learning neural networks. Fine. What is the lacuna of this multi-class, multi-layer feed-forward, fully connected neural network? The lacuna is that you have to work out these features. X1, X2, Xn, height of every student, weight of every student, you have to measure and apply as input to this network. Fine. Means you have to find out features of every input pattern on your own, apply those features to the network, and then only it will give you output, or you will be able to carry out training. But in real life, many times you cannot calculate these features by hand. The process of calculating features is called as handcrafted features, computing handcrafted features. You have to decide which features, you have to calculate features by your own hand and have to give it to the input of the neural network. In many real life applications, you do not know what are the features. even you cannot calculate directly the values of the features. So what will be my natural expectation? My natural expectation will be, I want something which will accept input as it is. I want to identify face, a particular face. It will accept face as input. Internally, it will calculate its feature and it will tell me whether he or she is my friend X or Y, whether he is my brother or sister or whatsoever. Fine. Means feature calculation should be automatic. That is the whole essence of going to deep neural network. That is the whole essence of going to deep neural network. In case of feed forward, multi-layer, multi-class, fully connected neural network, what you have to do? You have to decide features. You have to compute features and apply it to the neural network. Means you will have to handcraft the features. But in real life application, I do not want to waste my time and apply my brain in computing of those features. Neither I am bothered about which features it is going to use. So what will I require is, I will require a feature calculator. The feature calculator should calculate appropriate features, and those features should be applied at the input of this feed forward network. So naturally, the deep learning neural network, it has got two parts. So in conventional learning of patterns, inputs are pre-processed, appropriate features are selected, computed, etc. So these features are called handcrafted features, and these are further applied for feed forward neural network. But appropriate pre-processing, identification of appropriate features and avoiding insignificant features, all these things, those are very tedious. So what I want? I want something like deep learning algorithms. What do they do? They first use the available pattern directly as input without any pre-processing, feature computation, etc. And at the end, it directly gives me the result. So I am saved from the botheration of calculation of features, which features are being used, etc. That's why I many times say that if you do not want to learn anything, then use deep learning. You need not worry about which features you are using. How are the features calculated? It will calculate features and it will directly give the output. Now, why these are called as deep learning algorithms? The first reason is that the process of deep learning is the process of feature evaluation, multiple feature evaluation. Okay. They require multiple layer of neural networks. And that's why first reason is that as it requires multiple layers of neural network, it is called deep neural network. One thing. Second thing, if we compare it with our studies, we say that something I have studied in deep. What does it mean? Or you say that I have not studied that in deep. Means what? You have just taken a cursory reading. You do not know what are the multiple meanings. You have not analyzed what is written there. You have not inferred anything from it. You have just given a reading to it. Okay. But deep learning means what? You have to read it in depth multiple times. You will have to extract multiple meanings. Fine. You will have to extract multiple inferences from whatever is written there. That is what is deep learning. Similarly, in deep learning, you will find that an input pattern is analyzed multiple times. An input pattern is analyzed multiple times. How is it analyzed multiple times? It is analyzed multiple, rather, why is it analyzed multiple times? It is analyzed multiple times to extract different features. Multiple features. So you will have single input pattern and you will have 6-7 convolutional filters. You already know convolution. You have studied convolution for filtering in your digital signal processing or image processing. Many of you might have already studied Prebit mask, Sobel mask, and so on. All those masks, they were convolved they were convolved with the input image to obtain edges. Fine. And edges are one of the features of input image, as we already know. Similarly, there can be large number of convolution masks, might be 5, 7, 10, 20, how many, nobody knows. All these convolutional masks, what they will do is, they will detect features. Unnecessary features will be removed. How are they removed? We will study further. And after removing unnecessary features, whatever are the remaining features, they are applied to a feed-forward neural network. The feed-forward neural network again may have multiple layers. So altogether, if you see the commercially available deep neural networks, you may find that there are 100 convolutional layers. There are 200 convolutional layers, followed by that there are 20 to 30 feed forward neural network layers, even up to 100. So in total, the deep learning neural network may have 200, 300 layers of neurons. The depth of the neural network, that's why, is said to be high. And parallelly, it extracts more features, as if we are learning something in deep. When we learn something in deep, we find out multiple meanings of what is written there. We analyze what is written there. This is done by using multiple convolutional filters. And these are the reasons why these networks are considered as deep learning neural networks. Fine. What is the advantage? Advantage is that automatically the deep neural network, it finds out features and then they are classified using feed-forward neural network. So I will represent whatever I have discussed in brief like this. I have got input pattern. In the conventional classifier, what happens? You do pre-processing, you do denoising, you do feature identification, feature computation, insignificant feature reduction. Then the features are applied to classifier like neural network, fuzzy logic, statistical, and so on, Gaussian regression, classifiers, and so on. And the classifier will tell you this is smiley. Fine. In deep learning classifier, what happens? You do not calculate features on your own. Rather, there is a block. There is automatic multi-level unknown feature identification. Features you do not know. That's why unknown features. In the conventional, you know which feature you are using. Then there is feature computation, feature rejection. All this is done internally. You are not doing it. The block which is calculating these features, or in other words, it is encoding the information available in the input pattern into a feature vector, is called as autoencoder. The block which encodes the complete information, if not complete, close to complete information from the input pattern into a feature vector is called as autoencoder. And the output of the autoencoder is applied, as I have already told, fully connected feed-forward multi-layer multi-class neural network classifier, and that will tell you that the input pattern is smiley or otherwise. Fine. This is what is the main difference between conventional learning classifier and deep learning classifier. Same thing again, presented in a different way, input pattern I am applying. So this autoencoder, it contains convolutional neural network. Output of convolutional neural network is given to fully connected feed forward neural network classifier, and it will tell you output class. Fine. Now, for this, everybody has studied convolution. As you already know, your signal is supposed to be big in size, while the convolutional mask or convolutional window or convolutional filter is supposed to be small in size. And you scan the whole signal first along the row. Row by row, you have to scan the complete signal. Fine. And at every position of the signal, you calculate the multiplication of overlapping elements. Now, this this in the diagram, this has little bit displaced. Fine. So what I do is I pick up this matrix 1, 2, 9, 8, 5, 2, 7, 3, 1. You see value of F2 according to the process of convolution, as you know, the second matrix, or you call it filter function, it is mirror imaged twice, because the one dimensional convolution, it has got the component t minus tau. For that, to implement that, you have to mirror image the filter function. Now our filter function is two dimensional, so I will have to mirror image it first with respect to x axis and then with respect to y axis, as shown here. Cf2, it is written as f2 dash after mirror imaging, and this f2 dash will now be convolved over the function f1, and at every position this same color indicate overlapping of the element. If you overlap that 5 with 6 in f1, the position will be like this. So the multiplication will be multiplication at the position of 6 now in f1. It will be 5 multiplied by 1 plus 8 multiplied by 2 plus 3 multiplied by 9 and so on, plus 8 multiplied by 1 and so on. That value you will get as 155. Fine. Note this 5 multiply 6 by 6 at the center of the convolutional mask. So this position of 6 in the result matrix of convolution, I am replacing by the result 155. Note that your mask cannot reach to the boundary positions. That's why they are marked XXX. Or otherwise, if you want the center of the mask 5 to reach the boundary position, you will have to zero pad F1 by 1 from all sides. You will have to zero pad F1 by all sides. In that case, what will happen? This 5 can overlap with this 5, or this 5 can overlap with this 8, or 2 can overlap with 3, because there will be zero padding from all sides. So I hope you have, those who have studied image processing or some subject like computer vision, they might be already aware of such kind of zero padding operations. At the second position, which is shown by sky blue block, the convolutional calculated will be 171. Likewise, you can calculate convolution for all the positions of F1 excluding the boundary. And note that this boundary will be, if your filter matrix is of size 3 by 3, if the filter matrix is of size 3 by 3, then if this 3 is n, it should be n by 2, and then it is called as what? Flooring. 3 divided by 2 is 1.5, and flooring of 1.5 is 1. So you have to have zero pad from all sides of F1 by one position. So one row of 0 and one column of 0 will be added on all sides. Means one column of 0 on left side, one column of 0 on right side, one row of 0 at the top, one row of 0 at the bottom. If you do this, then you will be able to achieve this X marked elements. And this addition of zeros is called as zero padding Z. And the value of Z is calculated as size of the matrix, that is 3 by 3. I considered it 3 only because it is a square matrix. And 3 by 2 is 1.5. 1.5 floored gives you 1. So one row and one column will be added on all sides. So Z is equal to 1 for this example. Fine. Now, once you calculate the convolutional matrix like this, as you already know, depending upon the filter matrix elements, your convolution may be negative also, because convolutional filters, as you already know, they have negative elements. You have already studied Previate, then Roberts, then Sobel's. Some of the filters, they may have, especially high pass filters, they may have negative elements. And we use convolution for extraction of features, because you already know convolution operation is nothing but a filtering operation. And this filtering operation is going to give you features. That's why we use convolution and not correlation. There is comparable operation called correlation, but we use convolution for the simple reason, because we want features, and features are given by filtering. Fine. While the correlation gives you similarity. So we use convolution. Output of the convolution may be negative. So I have to use rectifying linear unit. You already know that wherever convolutional value is maximum, the features are supposed to be maximum. So I select maximum features because I want to avoid unnecessary data. So what I do is I use a block called as ReLU like this. What this ReLU will do is it will take the convolutional values. If convolutional value is greater than zero, it will be maintained as it is, zero or greater than zero, maintained as it is. If it is negative, it is left out. This is the process of rejection of unnecessary data. Negative convolutional values are removed. Only positive convolutional values are maintained, and negative convolutional values, they are converted to zero. That's why see here, when the input I has negative values, the transfer characteristic has got zero slope. Fine. That's why output will be zero. So after ReLU, only positive convolutional values will be maintained. Negative convolutional values will be left out. Fine. Now what will happen is, in that rectified convolutional values, I want to remove unnecessary positive values. First, using rectifying linear unit, I have removed negative values. Further, what I will do is, in a small given area, I will maintain only highest value and remove even positive values. So this will achieve feature compression for me. This will achieve feature compression for me. And the max pooling operator will give me compressed features. Now, how it exactly happens? To study that, we will move on to So this is how this convolution I am going to give it to you or your organizers. Later on, you can read this. I am not going to explain it. It is not possible also. So example of calculation of convolution I have given here. Now, here I will introduce a parameter stride. Stride means the value by which I shift a filter matrix. In digital image processing, when you apply Sobel's filter or Previate filter, usually you shift the matrix, that is convolutional filter matrix, by one position along the row and then by one position along the column. After the first row is over, first you shift along the columns, fine, and then along the rows. Now this shifting by one position is called as stride. So S is equal to 1 means you will shift the filter by one pixel position. If it is 2, then it means you will jump one position and shift the matrix by 2. Shift the convolutional matrix by 2. So what is achieved here? What is achieved here is one sample of convolution is missed. This is called as stride. Okay. Stride represents here jumping of the convolutional filter. If you start at a position n, if stride is equal to 1, you will go to the position n plus 1. But if stride is equal to 2, you will directly go to the position n plus 2 by skipping n plus 1. This is along the column. Along the row also, same thing will happen. Alternate row will be dropped. So 50% data reduction can be achieved along the rows, and 50% data reduction can be achieved along the columns. So what will happen is, overall, you will observe that a 100 by 100 matrix will result into, first you drop 50% rows, you will get a matrix of 50 rows, you will get 100 columns and 50 rows, then you drop 50 columns. So instead of 100 by 100 feature matrix, you will get 50 by 50 feature matrix. Number of elements wise, it is 25%. Okay. And number of area wise, it is a number of rows and number of columns wise, 50% data reduction is achieved. For very big input images, one may go for even higher values of S. That is the advantage of stride. You need not consider every convolutional sample. By using stride, you can achieve reduction of data which you require. Now, let zero padding is 2. Zero padding is 2 means what? You have to add 2 zeros on left side, 2 zeros and on right, 2 columns of zeros on right side, 2 rows of 0 at the top, 2 rows of 0 at the bottom. And your convolutional mask will be 5 by 5. I hope you understand this. If convolutional mask is 5 by 5, 5 divided by 2 is 2.5. Floor it. After flooring it, you will get 2. That 2 is equal to Z. Okay? If the mask size is 3, then the result of convolution is given by, now you calculate this. Fine. Stride, I have given 1. What will be result of convolution? This I leave for you as your exercise. Of course, this will be very simple for those who have studied image processing and computer vision. Others will have to put in little bit of thinking, but not at all difficult. Now, whenever I calculate this convolution is normalized. Okay. Now, this is given in detail in Gonzalez, so I won't be going into detail of that. For every position or every area, you can normalize the convolutional like this. The equations are given, so I won't go into details of this as we have got less time, and then I'm supposed to consider a few applications also. Now, max pooling, whether it is there. ReLU, I hope everybody has understood. ReLU means what? Positive values of convolution will be maintained as it is, including zero. Negative values will be converted to zero, just like our half wave rectifier. You already know in half wave rectifier, negative half cycle is converted to zero. Positive half cycle is maintained as it is. So at the output of rectifying linear unit, I get only positive values of convolution. And instead of negative values, I will get zero. Now there, I apply max pooling. Now see here, I have got this 4x4 matrix. Okay. I apply this 4x4 matrix. I divide this 4x4 matrix in these four parts. Okay. 1, 3, 9, 1, 1, 1, 5, 7, 15, 7, 11, 31, 19, 39, 51, 71, 51, 71. I have applied max pooling. First 2x2 portion, 7 is the maximum. I have taken 7. Second 2x2 part, 91 is maximum. I have taken 91. Third part, 71 is maximum. I have taken 71. Fourth part, maximum 71. I have taken 71. this operation is called as max pooling. Fine. But here you know that this 2 by 2 neighborhood, I have shifted directly from 1 to 91. The neighborhood is not overlapping. I could have also taken 3, 91, 7, 15. This as one of the matrix. In that case, the stride of max pooling should have been 1. But now the neighborhood is not overlapping of size 2 by 2. So after 1, I am directly considering 91 for the next 2 by 2 position. I am missing this 3 position. Okay. So I am jumping 1 position. That's why stride is considered 2. What I have achieved here? I have again achieved out of 16 elements, only 4 elements. So I can say that 75% of unnecessary data I have removed. 75% of unnecessary data I have removed. Earlier there were 16 elements. Now I have only 4 elements. And these 4 elements are supposed to have most important features of these 4x4, that is 16 elements. Now another max pooling example with 2x2 neighborhood and stride 1 is explained here with stride 1. Now see the black, this black dotted box. After 1, I am starting the block at 3. So my next block will be 3, 91, 7, 15. Now here stride is 1. I have shifted the black dotted box to the right side only by 1 position. So what will I get? After 7, I will get 91 maximum. Then shift it by 1 more position. It will now come to 91, 11, 15, 7. Again maximum is 91. Then downwards, instead of shifting by 2 just like others, just like earlier situation, I shifted by 1. Now 5 is at the top. 4 elements are 5, 7, 11, 13. Maximum is 31. Likewise, you go on finding out max of the 4 elements. You go on finding max of the 4 elements in the neighborhood and write that max in the resulting matrix. These operations, they are called as max pooling operations. Fine. After max pooling operation, what you get is the compressed feature of the input data. Okay. Now, I can in fact go back, but before that, I will explain this concept of autoencoder. I am showing here feed forward autoencoder. What is this feed forward autoencoder? It has got one input pattern. All its layers, they are feed forward neural network layers, as we studied earlier. And what is done is the size of layer 2 is less than layer 1. Size of layer 3 is less than layer 2. Then after L3, there is L4. Size of L4 is exactly same to L2, and slight size of L5, layer 5, in terms of number of neurons is exactly equal to L1. Now I train it in such a way that whatever is input f of xy applied, the same is the output. In the process, what I am doing, whatever are the features of f of xy, L1 is compressing it at the input of L2. L2 is further compressing the features at the input of L3. L3 is further compressing the features at its output, that is at the input of L4. And from this output, I am again constructing the approximate version of f of xy. Means, whatever are the features at the output of L3, it has got all necessary information of f of xy, or all necessary features of f of xy. Or in other words, all unnecessary features of input f of x, y, they are rejected, and only important features are maintained at the input of L3. And from the output of L3, I can reconstruct output f cap xy such that f cap xy and f of xy, the difference is bare minimum. The difference is bare minimum. If I am successfully able to do that, this means I have trained this autoencoder decoder combination. Now, once this autoencoder decoder combination is trained, means after applying the input f of xy, I get most accurate version at the output f cap xy. In that case, I can say that all the features of input f of xy are available at the output of L3. Fine. Now, what I can do is I can remove L4, L5, and the features at the output of L3 that I can use for whatsoever purpose. So this is nothing but feature compression by using feed forward autoencoder. Okay. Now the error here, the issue will be, what will be training algorithm? As usual, again, I'll be using gradient descent algorithm. Difference between output and input matrix difference will be considered as mean squared error. Mean squared error will be calculated from input and approximate version of input that is available at the output, and this mean squared error will be minimized. Fine. Thus, the autoencoder compresses all the input features at the output layer of L3, and I can apply these features for whatever purpose required. Fine. Now, this was about feed forward autoencoder description. Similarly, I can implement convolutional autoencoder. Now, this formula is very important. This C represents size of output. There is some mistake in this formula, I think. Capital N is size of the image. Okay. Z is zero padding. S is stride. Small n is size of the filter. This plus one should be outside. This plus one, I think it should be here. It is again mistake in typing. But anyway, there is a formulation which gives you size of output. Fine. This calculation might appear to be slightly wrong. But anyway, there is a mathematical formulation which gives you what is the output if the input size for the convolutional layer or convolutional autoencoder is n, filter size, convolutional filter size is small n, then z is number of zeros padded on left hand side, on right hand side, on top and of the and at the bottom of the input image. So this C will give you size of the output image, okay, or output feature matrix. Convolutional autoencoder works similar to the feed forward autoencoder. Fine. But note that training of convolutional autoencoder, it takes lots and lots of time. Note that many professional deep learning networks, they have been trained continuously for 1 month. Okay. They are high performance computing machines and servers. They were continuously training for 1 month or even more than that. And the output is available for general use. In general, people, they readily use that trained output, apply the input pattern, and get the output. And they say that we are working in deep learning. In fact, what they are doing is they are using only toolbox of deep learning. Just like you perform your full wave rectifier experiment using kit, they are using toolbox for convolutional neural network or deep neural network, applying input matrix and getting output matrix. They do not have any, insight into the process of deep learning. They are simply using the toolbox for like deep learning. Okay. I do not have any objection for that. You can definitely use toolbox, but what is exactly happening in that toolbox, that you must know. Even in our case, we have tried to train the network from scratch. Our machine with 3.6 gigahertz i7 and 4000 NVIDIA GPU cores took 8 days and nights of continuous training for training a football tracker, and still only 30% training was completed. You can imagine 4000 NVIDIA cores, GPU cores. It took continuous 8 days, day and night training, okay, for tracking football. And still, how much percentage of task was completed? Only 30%. So obviously, this training from scratch, it requires a lot of time. It requires a lot of time. So what we do is, we readily take the weights from the already trained network by professionals, and we start using it. Now I am returning back to the original presentation. So this feed forward autoencoder we have completed. Feed forward autodecoder is nothing but getting the approximate version of the input image. Convolutional autoencoder, further we will see how it works. Now see this architecture. I am applying image of size capital N by capital N. So capital N is my input pattern. Whatever I am showing by orange boxes, it is nothing but convolutional filter. Okay. Its size is small n, let it is equal to 5. Fine. Zero padding I have done by 2. Why zero padding is done by 2? Because n is equal to 5. Okay, so 5 divided by 2 is 2.5. Floor it, you will get 2. That's why 0 pad z is equal to 2. And stride is equal to 2 means I am jumping the position of convolutional mask by 2. Even max pull stride also, I am doing the same thing. I am taking 2 by 2 neighborhood for max pull, and they are non-overlapping like explained in our earlier example. Now we can calculate our output size. Suppose I have got input image of size 100 by 100. We can apply that formula. Capital N plus Z minus N divided by S plus 1. The formula is like this, that plus 1 should be separate. So what will be the size? You can calculate it. I don't have any whiteboard here readily available with me, so I cannot do the calculations, but you can do it. Capital N is equal to 100. N is equal to 5. Zero pad is equal to 2. S is equal to 2. So this can give me the output size of the convolution. Corresponding to each convolutional mask, I will get 6 corresponding convolutional outputs. I have got 1 input image. I have got 6 convolutional filters. They are going to give me 6 different types of features. Okay. But what is my stride? Stride is 2. So what will happen? Output will be N by 2 by N by 2. Means 50% reduction is row, 50% reduction in columns. If I take in terms of area, it will be 25%. For every convolutional mask, I will get 6 such outputs. Fine. Then I will apply ReLU. ReLU means what? All negative values will be dropped. Then I take max pull. All these 0 values will also be dropped, because max pull selects only maximum value of the 4 as I have already discussed. After that also, after max pool also, I get half the number of rows and half the number of columns, because four elements are replaced by one maximum element. So at the output of this first convolutional layer, what size I will get? n/4/n/4. And this will be there for every convolutional mask. So I am getting 6 matrices of n/4/n/4. Earlier, what was the size available? What was the size available? Size available was n/n. If I consider stride 1 and 6 convolutional masks, I would have got 6 images of n/n. But now what I am getting? 6 images of n/4/n/4. So this is in itself 75% reduction in unnecessary features. Okay. Now, in the first layer, I was having 6 filters. In the second layer, I can again have 6 filters. I can again have 6 filters. So what will happen? Each of this n/4/n/4 block, it will result into 6 blocks of what size? n/16/n/16. So I will total get at the output of CNN2, I will total get 36 blocks, and each block is of n/16/n/16. Fine. At the output of CNN3, I will get 36 into 6, because at the output of CNN3, there are going to be 6 into 6, 36 inputs, 36 multiplied by 6, because there are 6 convolutional matrices. So 36 multiplied by 6, whatever is the number, 216 or so. But the size now will be n/64/n/64. So as you go on doing it, you will go on getting smaller and smaller matrices, but larger in number. At the output of first convolutional neural network, that is represented by red dotted block, I am getting 6 outputs from one image. CNN2, in the purple layer, each of this image again is going to be processed by 6 filters. So I will get 6 into 6, 36 at the output of CNN2. At the output of orange block, I am getting 36 multiplied by 6, something like 216. Okay. But size of each block will be n/64/n/64. Then what I can do is, all these features, 216 small matrices of n/64/n/64 size, they can be concatenated together to form a feature vector. And you already know, feature vector is of the size, means only one column, large number of rows. By concatenating all these matrices, I can get a feature vector. And these feature vectors are now applied to fully connected feed forward perceptron classifier. Thus, you can clearly see this architecture of deep neural network. First portion, that is colored portion, red block, purple block, and orange block, they are convolutional layers. And as I have already told you, I have shown here only 3 layers, but commercial neural networks, they have got up to 300 convolutional layers. You can imagine, 300 convolutional layers. Here for feed forward layer, I have shown only 1, 2, 3 layers, including output. In the commercially available, already trained deep neural networks, these layers can be up to 25 and even 100. Okay. Finally, the number of outputs will match the number of classes, and whatever is input pattern you provide at the input of convolutional neural network, it will be classified appropriately. Fine. So this is what is the architecture of deep learning network. Okay. If you see commercial architectures, same idea will be there. Only number of CNNs will be large. Number of filters will be different. And so on. But let me tell you, there is no such theory to tell you how many layers will be suitable for a particular application. Just like in neural network, you can decide number of input neurons, input nodes, that is matching to number of features. You can decide number of output neurons, that is equal to number of classes. But how many hidden layers should be there? And how many neurons should be there in each hidden layer? There is no theory to tell this. It is dependent, highly dependent on application. Fine, there are some thumb rules, but those are not always applicable. Now, when it comes to training of CNN layers, there will be an issue. How are these weights of convolutional filter, these six matrices, convolutional filter matrices, will be computed? To start with, in the first iteration, these are selected randomly, just like we randomly initialize weight matrix in feed forward networks. Convolutional filters initially are selected randomly, and then using gradient descent with moment, gradient descent with or back propagation with moment algorithm, momentum algorithm is used for computing or modifying these convolutional filter coefficients. Fine. The algorithm used for this is nothing but the gradient descent algorithm, or in neural network terminology, we call it backpropagation algorithm, backpropagation with momentum algorithm. Fine. Then, instead of that nonlinearity I already told you, you can use tan hyperbolic, softmax, and so on. These are some notes on training of CNN layers. These are some of the scope of research. Fine. I am winding this up, and in the last 10 minutes or so, I will explain one project which we have implemented for tracking of vehicles using the available deep learning networks. So these are some of the examples of nets. In our work, we have used YOLO V3, V4 and V5 for tracking of vehicles using deep learning. As far as this presentation is concerned, that is fine. If you have any doubt or difficulty as far as convolutional neural networks are concerned, you can raise it now. After this, we will go to the presentation on automatic number plate recognition for vehicles. What we have done is we have installed a camera on Nagpur-Hyderabad road. We have taken readings of that. That is the final project. We have completed more than 80% of its work, and we have used YOLO networks for that, for tracking of the vehicle. Speed of the vehicle is to be measured, and then number plate of the vehicle is to be automatically read. Okay. And of course, if the speed is greater than the given limit, then automatic challan can be generated for such overspeeding vehicles. This is a project given by one agency to our department under my coordinatorship, and we are doing that. Any doubt you want to have, any discussion related to the issues discussed so far? Or should I move to directly to that presentation? So yeah, are you able to see this new slide, real time overspeed detection?
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay. So we'll take it at the end. Questions we can take at the end, and we'll go ahead with this number plate recognition slide. So this is one introductory slide. The vehicle is moving like this. It is captured. First, I have to separate the vehicle from the background. Okay. We have done is using YOLO version 5 network. Initially, we implemented with YOLO V3, but finally, we understood that YOLO V5 is providing much better performance. So for tracking of the vehicle, initially, we used it. So there might be some bike in the picture. I will have to separate it, and I will have to separate only four wheelers because our project is related to number plate reading of four wheelers. I may get such patches. Number plates also might be written in different forms. Somebody may write in a single line ABC1234, ABC1234 in two lines, and so on. Both of these should give the same number plate reading. Fine. And unnecessary patterns like this additional information, Rio de Janeiro and all that dash, they should be neglected. And only these big numbers, they should be interpreted. Fine. Our process is like this. We first separate vehicle, then we separate number plates. Then these number plates, they are subjected to OCR. For OCR also, we have used deep learning neural network. Every character is cropped, and all those cropped characters, they are read individually by using OCR, optical character recognition, like ABC1234 separately. Then we form a vehicle number like this. Fine. And in the process, what happens is, as I get multiple snaps of the vehicle, it is quite possible that the number plate, some portion of the number plate may get reflected. Okay, there might be reflection, and the camera might not be able to read that particular character. So what we do is, we read the number plate large number of times, and then we calculate majority vote for every character. Then we calculate majority vote for every character. For example, I have read the number plate four times, and I got four results, ABC1234. So A is there out of four times, three times A is there. So I consider it A. B is there three times, so I consider it B. C is there three times, one times it was considered similar character G. So I consider it C. Similarly for 1234, voting is carried out, and finally the number is worked out. Fine. This is the overall conceptual presentation of the work. Our approach was like this. First is vehicle tracking for speed detection. What we have done is, every frame, actual frames are in 4K by 6K size. We are using true full video size. What is it called? Something like UHD or SHD, super high resolution frames, 4K by 6K frames, or TV resolution frames. So all those frames, they are applied to YOLO version 5, and it gives us vehicle detection. As I already told you, in every frame, vehicle detection is done using deep learning. Fine. Now, when this vehicle is detected, that vehicle is bounded by a bounding box like this red bounding box. Okay. And the red bounding box defines the position of the vehicle. Now, when this vehicle comes closer to camera or moves away, then the displacement in the bounding box using number of pixels is counted. Okay. And every frame has got its frame duration depending upon the video frame rate. So I have got displacement of the vehicle using position of the bounding box. Then I have got time using the number of frames. Every frame has got fixed time depending upon the frame rate. I can calculate speed of the vehicle. And I will have to store it. While storing the speed, I will have to also store the snapshot of the vehicle. Because you already know, if some challan is there, on that challan, you will have to print the photograph of the vehicle also and its speed. Fine. So for that purpose, I will have to detect this bounding box. As I have already described, I can measure speed also. So vehicle bounding box detection and tracking using deep learning will be your first step. License plate detection is second stage. Because even if I detect vehicle, many vehicles, they have got number plates located at different positions. So I will have to search for license plate. That second step is called as license plate detection. That is again done using deep learning. Once I detect license plate, I will have to detect, read every character in the license plate. I will have to remove unnecessary data. Okay. And thus I can read vehicle number. Fine. Now here we are unable to use our true photographs in the presentation. Because we are agreement bound to the company. But some of the results definitely I can share. At the end, I will share a video which is able to show you the results. Fine. So this is an overview of the task, object detection, localization, and all those things. I won't go into details of this because now my aim is not to show you the theoretical stuff or descriptive stuff. The idea of the project, all of you might have already had. We have used object detection algorithm using deep learning. And let me tell you why to use YOLO. It is more than 100 times faster than your RCNN. In fact, RCNN and fast RCNN, they were itself faster. But YOLO is more than 100 times faster. Different versions are more than 100 times faster than RCNN and fast RCNN. And that's why we are using YOLO algorithm. This is YOLO architecture design. I won't go into details of that. These are all online available details available. This is taken from YOLO version 4 paper. If you require references, those are available with me. So why YOLO? These are comparison of different algorithms. SOTA released in mid-2020. YOLO is the latest algorithm that fits in our requirements. It gives good accuracy on segmentation tasks. Segmentation means vehicle detection tasks. Computational complexity. Comparatively, it is light on computation and easy to deploy on GPUs because we have to deploy our work on GPUs. It can be further extended to recognize type of vehicles, whether it is a two-wheeler, four-wheeler, or light motor vehicle, heavy motor vehicle, and so on. And YOLO algorithm is mostly trained. We have to take the trained weights and we have to further tune it only. So the training will be faster. So these are some of the execution parameters. We have trained it for 5,200 epochs. It required 8 hours. And final loss observed was this. In fact, these some of the performance metrics, they are related to execution of the algorithm. And now I will directly come to some of the results. These are again not our results, but what our results will implement. See this photograph. You will find it is identifying cars. We won't be identifying bicycles at this stage. Fine. This type of output we have implemented. And these are the readings. What we have done is we have taken these number plates and applied to our OCR, trained OCR network. And these are some results of execution. In most of the cases, you find that those are read correctly. Performance matrix, this is again accuracy evaluated on different databases. We could achieve so far 96.3% and so on various databases. Then beyond that, we have done one interesting work, that is neural network style transfer. If you see, this is a new vehicle while it is raining. So this raining will create some noise in the number plate. Okay. So what we can do is we can transfer this raining style to the actual number plate. Or there might be fog. We can transfer fog to the number plate. For example, this is number plate. How will it look in fog? It will look like this. You can see the last column. In fog, it will look like this. And our network will be trained so that even in presence of fog, it will be able to identify the or read the number plate. Even if it is raining, see the second row. Even if it is raining, this rain can be transferred on the number plate, and number plate will be read even in presence of the rain distortion. Fine. So this mathematical algorithms and all that, I won't go into details of this. Final output of this in last 1 or 2 minutes, I will show you. I will try to open the video and let me see. What is the reason? Due to some reason, it is not. These are videos recorded by us. Just let me see. Huh. So, are you able to see these videos? Hello?
Vinma sir, currently it is showing that you are starting to share content, but nothing is coming.
Is it? On my screen, it has already started.
Yes, now PPT is there. Sir, it might be happen that starting you have shared the PPT and not complete screen.
How to share these videos?
Sir, first stop sharing the current window.
I should be able to share the video. Stop sharing?
Yes.
Okay.
Now click on share and complete screen.
I will close down this existing. These things?
Yes.
Existing presentations. Okay. Now what should I do? I have closed.
Share content and then complete screen.
Share, first share, then screen.
Yes.
I have done share screen. Fine. Now if I execute, will it show the video?
Yes, sir, but currently, Miss, we are not getting anything. The screen is not yet shared.
Actually, Vipin, while sharing, we may have to select the option optimize for motion and video while sharing the screen. So after that, it will play with computer audio.
Yeah.
Share the content is there, right? So drop down box is there. So after that, you need to connect motion and video.
No, I have.
I have on my screen now. I have a video playing, which is playing that video clip and speed of every vehicle and its photograph.
No,
is recorded, but yes, I don't think you are able to see it.
No, sir.
If I send you video file,
yes, sir, I'll share it.
Will you be able to play it?
Yes, sir.
I will do this then. It is 12 megabyte video, so I will send one video only at a time. Just a minute. Yeah, I have sent from my side.
Let me refresh it. Sir, you have shared on my Gmail?
No, triple IT mail. This sharing.
Yes, I have received it.
Try to play it.
Yes.
This is only vehicle detection and speed measurement part of it. Automatic number plate recognition is not part of this video which I am showing you. Now you won't be able to see it into this thing. Video is very smooth, but due to our data transfer rate,
yes,
this is a 4K by 6K video actually. So you can see the speed of each vehicle and its photo. Okay, now see this white car, see the photo is there, speed measurement is also there. And the speed is measured between these two green lines. As soon as the vehicle passes, its photograph is there and speed is there. Fine, now see this truck coming, see its speed and this thing. Okay, in fact, one more application you are going to see, and I hope you have arranged lecture of Paresh.
Paresh sir was busy in this week, so he recommended one of his friend. He is giving on the same topic from OZ Sports.
Okay. So he will be showing you very interesting application of football tracking. using deep learning neural networks. So he also completed under me. So with these two, I think you will get idea about capabilities of deep neural network. Because other algorithms, if you do not use deep neural network, more or less it was taking 40 seconds for every vehicle to detect the vehicle and measure its speed and read number plate. Now we have brought down that duration from 40 to 50 seconds per vehicle to around 4 to 5 seconds per vehicle. In 5 seconds, you will measure speed of vehicle. You will detect the complete vehicle, okay, and you will also read its number plate. That is the task which is achieved in around 5 seconds. It is closely, even if a human being starts writing the number plate, he is going to take 2-4 seconds, isn't it? So it is close to real time. Fine. So that's all from my side. And I think, when is your second next session? 4:30 or 4?
No, sir. Daily 3 sessions only. Tomorrow 10:30 a.m. we have another session.
Okay. Then the audience may raise some questions, or if they have any doubts, any clarifications are needed. Fine, it seems that nobody has any doubt. So it means that either my presentation was understood by everybody, or it was not understood by anybody. So these two, both possibilities are there. Anyway.
Okay, thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. It was really insightful for.
Where will we receive this PPT? Copy of PPT I will share with Vipin, Professor Vipin, and he will share those presentations with you. Might be at the end of the course. I do not know what protocol they are.
After the end of the activity, we'll share with them.
At the end of the activity, you can share it. Fine?
Okay.
So, thanks all. Thanks, Vipin, for giving me this opportunity to interact with so many young brains. And I hope they will try to implement such projects. Let me tell you, though it appears difficult, it is not at all difficult, because most of the online help is available, and your students, they will be very much thrilled to do such projects, and they'll be very happy, because otherwise implementing all this using conventional algorithm is really, really difficult and lengthy. Those who are working in the field of image processing, computer vision, they may realize this. Even for simple object detection, you will have to write 400, 500, 700 lines of code. And here we are doing everything in video and in very close to real time. Fine. So that's all from my side. So you can miss you can disconnect me from the session, Vipin.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session and taking out time from your busy schedule. Thank you once again. I'm closing this meeting.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.